afternoon. I guess we'll get started. I am Jake Delphia. I'm a senior energy advisor for USAID's Governing for Growth. There's a wonderful banner up here. I was asked if I would give. I just now understand that it's a lecture. I'm not a professor. I used to be a professor of pre-calculus, in calculus in university, but I've never been, you know, sort of an audience. 2 weeks ago, I guess I was in Mexico providing training to 520 participants. This is a much easier audience, and I would appreciate some interaction. I don't want to be up here talking the whole time. It would be nice if you would interrupt me from time to time and say, what are you talking about? Or I have a different idea or thought. So that would be good. What is this for? Oh no. Anything I can change? Yeah. All right. Oh, who am I? Okay. I'm the old guy. I worked 20 years in the industry, within the power and gas industry. I was head of planning, head of a whole bunch of stuff. I actually changed the way that FERC, the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, looks at contracts. We used to have a contract only once a month. With some work, and I pushed these guys to change to hourly. Well, guess what? That's what I'm trying to do here in Georgia. Right as we speak, the exact same topic, and we're going to be successful here, as I was in the United States. And I've supported electricity reforms in over 70 countries. And this is why I look like the way I do. Extremely tired. And I worked here, as many of you might know, I worked here from 2010 to 2015 on a full-time basis as chief of party on a couple of energy projects. And my degrees, if you even care, are math and physics with an MBA with concentration in finance, which I'd say all of them have been very helpful over the years. I love to use boards. So and many of the people will know from this place that from ISET, we took on seven people who came from the energy training within ISET, joined groups that I was chief of party on. And all but Sophia have moved on to other things. Sophia has stayed with us. And others have moved into GNERC and into other things. So ISET, I know of, is a wonderful institution for preparing students, you know, into the power sector. And I thank the organization, the professors and so forth. They're doing a great job. Okay, I guess that's the introduction. We're going to talk today about congestion. What it is, and I want to use the board for a while, and I want to use an analogy, and I think that's probably the better way to do it, and then we can get into some of the more details. If we have a river, I'm going to use transportation as the analogy. We have a river, and we have a factory over here, and we have residential guys over here, some communities, let's say. What's the problem here? Well, the problem is you got to get these guys to here. So you build a bridge, right? And life is good. Now we have a place to transport, the analogy, transport people to work and then back home at nighttime. Now, what happens? Let's say we build another bridge or another factory. We build some more homes here. What's going to happen to this bridge? Going to get fuller, right? It's going to get... And if you keep doing this. And you keep doing this. Eventually, you're going to run into a problem. All the people running here are going to find that this bridge is congested. Right? Is it congested in only one direction? In the morning, anybody who's driven in this traffic in the morning in Tbilisi understands rush hour. Go in the morning, it goes this direction, right? And what happens in the evening? It goes that direction. So we have congestion, and I will say this is a physical congestion. There are two types of congestion. There is physical and economic. We're going to talk about initially physical congestion. This is the only thing that an electricity transmission system operator will be looking at, unless somebody makes noise. And that's what that thing is about up there. We'll talk about that. How do you relieve this? How are you going to relieve this physical congestion? Anybody have an idea how you could relieve it?
Build more bridges.
There we go. Right? That's an excellent idea. Guess what? Somebody's going to have to pay for that, right? Let's put a toll here. And let's put a toll here and have people pay for this. And then and return back. And then return over time, it'll return. That's one option. Anybody have another option that could happen? Yeah.
Build the residential area into the...
Hey! Build the guys over here, and they can go there. There's one more option.
Build a tunnel underwater.
Bridge.
Boats.
Boats? Yeah. How about a factory here? What about that? I mean, these guys can go this way. So, what does traditional power sector say? Build the bridges. They'll say build the investment. Let's you know, it's a good, I'll say Soviet style. Let's just build infrastructure. We love that. So that's what we're talking about. So there's one more term that you should understand. There's a limitation here, right? There's a limitation of getting across. And this limitation, this point, this river, let's call this the interface. The interface from one part of the economy to another part of the economy. This is the interface. I'm going to use that term because I want to use it in the electricity sector. This concept right now is a big deal in Georgia. Very big deal. And a lot of investment depends upon if the interface can be uncongested. Huge amount of investment is being made. We need to get rid of it. Now, there's one more other thing. Let's say that I build a private bridge. I'm building some guys here, and I'm building a factory here, and I'll just buy, and I'll build my own private bridge. And I'll just do that, and everything will be okay, right? No. Guess what happens? These guys don't want to go through this horrible traffic, right? What do? They sneak down, come through here, and go through there.
Aren't they paying tolls on
this? No, they're getting this for free. Yes. This is referred to as loop circuits or loop flows. Let's call it loop flows. happens all the time. It is, let me see if I'll spell this wrong, and everybody will tell me what it is. Kirchhoff. Everybody's hearing Kirchhoff laws? Yeah? Kirchhoff is the most important guy when it comes to understanding the flow of electricity. You have a contract with somebody here and a contract with somebody there. I'm going to go from here to here, right? No, not with electricity. Electricity goes where there is least resistance. It's the same thing in water, it's the same thing in everything else. Where there's least resistance, that's where electricity will flow. And you just see here, there's least resistance across this bridge. People are going to take this bridge until it actually fills up. That's an important issue when it comes to payments of transmission systems. I thought that was okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's an analogy. Okay. Now we want to move this in the electricity sector. Down. This is down. Yeah. I need my kids to help me with the control unit. Yeah. Okay. You have all, many of you are students and going to the university. These are my professors. These are the guys that I believe in. And these are the guys that I argue with all the time. Bill Hogan, PhD, MIT. Extremely smart guy. Paul Josko, same thing. These are the brains behind market. If you want to know and you want to read something, Stephen Stopp's book on electricity markets, extremely well written in plain language, but it really will, you know, take you, you know, a week to read it. It's detailed, but it's written in such a way that you will understand markets and everything that I'm talking about. Do they all agree? No way. They don't agree on a lot of things. Are markets constantly changing? Yes. And we're constantly learning. There's a reason why, and I'm going to talk about why I disagree with Mr. Hogan, and that's what this lecture is all about. But he's a brilliant man. I won't take that away. He's helped develop an extremely huge piece of software. And that's what nodal pricing is about. So, congestion, let's talk about engineering perspective. A need for new facilities to ensure reliability of the power system. So when you're GSE, everybody knows GSE, the TSO, transmission system operator, they're not looking for economic problems. They're looking to make sure the system operates fully on 99.99% of the time. You can't get better than that. If there is a problem of getting power from one part of the country to another, which would be congestion, then they're interested. They're saying this could be a reliability problem. USAID and somebody else just built, what was it, Horga? We spent lots of money. U.S. government out in western Georgia for the very reason I'm just talking about, to eliminate congestion, and also when there's an interruption, power outage, the lines are going to be there. So USAID has done a lot to ensure that congestion has been removed from Georgia. So, and they've been working closely with GSE, and again, the only thing that they're worried about is not how cheap the power system is. It's how reliable it is. It's not their responsibility to see how it's cheap. The responsibility of how low prices are customers and traders. So, but from an economics perspective, it's quite different. Economic congestion occurs when the prices in one region are different than the prices in another region. So let's say you have twice as much price in one region as another. And you say, okay, that's easy. Just send it across the bridges, right? Just send it across the transmission lines, you know, the cheaper power, and we'll equalize onto the system. What happens is, though, sometimes those bridges get clogged up. Does it hurt from a reliability perspective? No. There's enough generation on both sides to run the system reliably. But what happens is between this interface, there's cheaper power on one side that can't get into the region where there is more expensive power. And that is economic congestion. Yes? Mm-hmm. Clear or not clear? Should I try to give an example? Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay. Maybe I took a couple of leaps there. I'm gonna take my coat off.
Yeah. Whew. There's a tad one.
I had a professor once who used to do this. He'd come into the class. He'd have a pipe in his mouth. He'd go around for 10 minutes. He put the pipe down and he'd reach in his pocket and put another pipe in his mouth. And just keep him. The whole thing was lit in his pocket. So I don't know, are all professors crazy or? It's good to be crazy, right? It gets people's attention. That's what reminded me of taking my coat off. All right. So, okay. I'm a math major, I am not an artist. All right. There we go.
You're definitely not an artist.
I have nothing to do with an artist.
Okay. It's an amoeba, you know. Okay. And, yeah, this goes up here and like this. Okay. So here we have Angouri, biggest power plant in the country. Here we have the Blazy, the largest load. Largest supplier. Why is this here? That's where the water is. Why is this here? I don't know. But you gotta get
water as well.
You gotta get this there, right? You gotta get it down here. And we do have the 500 kV Kafkasia line that runs from Russia down here, right? And I'd say a lot of times there are no problems, but there are times. I'll call this the interface. The bridges get clogged. Where are people building most of the new hydropower plants? Here?
No.
Certainly not here. Paravani, you know, maybe a couple here. Right here, right? Mm. It's here. Hmm. Load is where? Here. Where's generation coming? Here. Good idea. Well, it's cheap. It's cheap, but you can see what's going to happen, right? One of the things we have is, oh my goodness, this is horrible. How did I do that? We have this guy. This is the entertainment center for Turks. Okay, we know that. And because USAID and others have invested heavily around Poti area, in this whole area, they have beefed up this. There used to be an interface here, but with a lot of support from the donors, they've eliminated, at least, you know, from a reliability purpose, the interface has been eliminated. It's gone. That was good news, because this growth is enormous. Of course, we have the Jara Scala coming in, right? It's 100 and, well, it changes on a daily basis, but then 180, let's say. 185, and then I heard another number yesterday from Tata. But anyways, it's in that ballpark. What's nice is it's going to be down in here, right? It's going to be located close to that area. So you'll have generation close to the new demand. That's great. That's actually, you're on the right side of the bridge. Finally got that, but not here. We still have this issue here. Let's say that this is 5 cents a kilowatt hour. Energy could be 3 cents, it could be 7 cents. Let's just say it's 5 cents. And on down here, what do we have here? At this point, thermal power plants, right? TTP. PPP. Thermal power plants. Let's just don't worry about natural gas prices and everything else. Let's just say that it's 10 cents a kilowatt hour. You can see there's a problem. This is the load. This is the generation. And this load is increasing. Not hopefully, I think. Ministry says 5% a year, okay? And after, 10 years, you've got a huge load. You're building up here. You are automatically growing yourself into a problem, a congestion problem. And that should be thought through. Remember the analogy? The analogy said what? If you have congestion, what do you do? Build a bridge? Somebody said build a bridge. I remember that. So maybe we can build another bridge, Build another line down here. Cheap? How much does this thing cost?
$700,000
per kilometer or something. That's pretty good. Mm-hmm. Okay. You can a million a mile. Same thing.
Dollars or
money?
So,
dollars.
It's a lot of money. Can you save money doing that? I don't know. Are there other options? Well, they thought maybe Dariali, 100 megawatts. And they tried. I mean, they're trying. The problem is, somebody got to build a transmission line up there. Anybody know the Aragvi River? Military road? Lovely place. I love that area. I don't want any stinking 500 kV line running up through there, but that's where it's going. It has to. I mean, it's got to bring the power down. Yep. So, that may help relieve. That's good. At least it's one thing on this side. It'll help relieve this problem, but doesn't resolve this problem. What does the TSO say? TSO says, I don't care. I'm fine. I have enough generation. I got generation. If I have a reliability problem, I just run it. I run my generation. So from a reliability perspective, engineering perspective, there's not congestion. There's only congestion because of economics. That's the only thing created. And I'll ask you the question, but I don't want you to answer it. I'll ask you the question, should a TSO build transmission facilities or do some other purchases of generation to offset economic congestion? If you know the answer to that, would you talk to Mr. Hogan and Mr. Joskow and those guys? Because they don't know the answer. But it is the big question now, because this is a market issue. This is not a system issue, it's an economic issue. And is it important? It's extremely important. There's actually on the Turkish side, there's a huge congestion going on. And there right now, a lot of investment has been made inside Georgia to sell power into Turkey. They can't do it. It's not just economic congestion. Okay, there's enough power in Turkey to supply two Turkeys. So it is an economic problem, economic congestion. But there's also a treaty that said, we'll provide you the transmission capacity. What they didn't tell you is, They'll provide it at the border, but they can't provide it at the interface inside. There's an interface inside Turkey that they can't get through. So, was this better? Getting better? Understanding a little bit better? Yeah? Come on, where am I? There?
There.
Okay. So, what kind of markets are there? Competitive electricity markets. How many are there? Bilateral contracts between two parties. Contract, buy and sell power. Day ahead market, sometimes called power exchange. Selling power today, arranging for today for sales tomorrow, by hour or less than 1 hour increments. Hour ahead market, I wonder what hour ahead market means. I think it means selling the next hour, right? Yeah. And I love the acronym HAM. Yeah. It's a great thing. The next one is, it depends on what part of the world you are in. It's either the RTM, the real-time market, or the balancing market. And basically, it's a market that allows the TSO to make sure that supply equals demand. Why? Because Kirchhoff said so. Kirchhoff said, you can't just say, oh, wait a couple minutes, I'll get you that electricity. If you use it, it has to be generated. There's no option. If it's generated, it has to be used. And that's what the real-time market does, or balancing market does. Ancillary services. It's ancillary. It means you're not buying and selling power. It means that those types of services that are needed, but not provided through buys and sells. And frequency control, the frequency here is 50 hertz, right? 50 hertz. Who provides frequency control for Georgia?
Dispatch.
It determines it, but what generator provides it? What generator in the system provides frequency control? It's not in Georgia. And this is one of the biggest issues we have to deal with. It's Russia. Mm-hmm. Russia's generators in the North Caucasus, way to the north of North Caucasus, provides a frequency control inside Georgia. It's one of the ancillary services that's provided here. What happens if a unit trips? Boom. Do your lights go out? No, you might see a flicker. You might see the lights get a little yellow, but all of a sudden the lights come back up. Somebody is sitting there with a generator rotating, waiting for that to happen. That person or that thing happening, making sure there's reserve there, is called operating reserves. And that is also an ancillary service. Last year, the power went down, maybe it was 2 years ago. The power went down here, and the whole system was flat for several hours. Why? I know this is going to be, you're going to think I'm nuts. Why did that happen? Because somebody didn't charge their batteries. Really? Hydropower plants are supposed to have reserves of batteries sitting aside. Just in case the system goes down, the batteries can provide electricity to their generator exciters. That didn't happen, and those batteries are sitting there. And, you know, the TSO is saying, start, I can't. Why didn't you? Nobody paid me. Nobody paid me for that service. And that's what's going to happen. And you're going to see this happen quite a bit from now on. Capacity market. What is capacity market? It is ensuring that if you need the capacity, say 10 megawatts, it will be there. What about solar panel or solar PVs? Can they provide in the capacity market? No. Can wind? No. They can't. Nature tells them when they can have capacity. Can Gardabani plant?
No.
Mostly, yeah. Those are the types of plants that can give you, you know, assured capacity. Anguri, probably Anguri's not a good example. So these are the plants that will operate in the capacity market. As there are more and more renewable energy, you will see more and more capacity markets appearing. For a while, people said you don't need a capacity market. You just set out there energy and the market will tell you all the prices. Well, okay, that was another thing Bill Hogan said, and it didn't come up true. Capacity markets are needed, especially when you have such a huge integration of renewable power. The derivatives markets, calls, puts, and so forth, I won't talk about that. I can talk about that another time, but I won't talk about that today. And then futures is something that it's a long-term forward that can turn into a contract in the near term. Again, this is something for the future.
Why futures is not included under derivatives, Mark?
Because Jake likes to separate them out. I like to think of derivatives. I know, you're right.
But if you mean forward contracts under futures, you're right.
You're right. But I like to think of a derivative in the short term, and the futures is the long term. But it doesn't have
from
to be.
From financial sector side?
No. I know, and other. Okay. You're right. It's just that Jake likes to separate out. I like, from my background, when we used to have power flowing across into Long Island from Connecticut. That's usually my wife calling me. That's why I get nervous. We would have a call, and so if the line on the underwater was disconnected between Connecticut, we would have a call, and we could just call upon a generator, and they would produce the power for us on Long Island if ours was disconnected. So we paid just a little bit of money for them to stay on standby. It's better than sitting there getting nothing. If you're a generator and you get nothing from here, and you want to do something to pay back your investment, being in the derivatives market, at least you get something. You're not just sitting there earning nothing. And that's why in the derivatives market, it's really nice to have at least somebody who cares to pay you once in a while. And you'll get your money back once you generate anyways, during that backup period. But you're getting paid to stand there on call. Yeah. There's many of those different ways to do derivatives. Okay. All right. So commercial trade is bilateral contracts. Correct? Two people, two firms, whatever it means. Market clearing price. Has anybody ever seen ISET supply and demand curve? No. Okay. So you derive a MCP, right? A market clearing price. And you do this for the day ahead. You do it at least every hour of the next day, or maybe every half hour of the next day. For the hour ahead, again, it could be every hour, it could be every half hour, it could be every 15 minutes. And some markets now, they're every 5 minutes. Every 5 minute biddings. Okay. So what's the difference? Okay. What's really interesting about using market clearing price? You get the customer input. Where if you use below the short run marginal cost, which is used in the real-time market, and in the ancillary services market, you don't get the customer input. Why is that important? Maybe the price you're trying to offer for a good is too expensive. All of a sudden, and this is where the change in the markets are now driving, is in the market clearing price, okay? This is a topic, I'm sorry, this is a long topic and should be really, because what's happening is customers are starting to take over the power systems. And the revolution has begun. I'm not crazy, guys. The revolution has begun. If you need to look under California ISO, CAISO. Look what is happening. Look at the duck curve. Duck curve, they call it, man? I call it duck diagram. It sounds better if it's duck diagram, but it's a duck curve. Look what customers are doing, how much involvement consumers are having in dictating how much power is needed, what price they're willing to pay, what kind of services they want, how much services they're going to even provide. It's an incredible revolution that's going on. And it's not just in the US. It's in many countries. It's starting to happen. In fact, we met with Irina today from GNERC, and I think she got the feel of it. She's gotten the feel of it. She's already seen investors who are interested at the distribution level, making a difference at the distribution level. Huge change, guys. Customers, it used to be this is the only place where customers could get their voices heard, was under the dam and the ham. That is changing. The revolution is starting to happen. So, now, nodal pricing. Not, this thing is so foreign from anything European you will ever hear about. We don't do nodal pricing in this part of the world. Nodal pricing is in the United States and across Central America and down into Central or South America. Mr. Hogan, Mr. Joskow, and et cetera, can be blamed for this. What it means is that every pricing node, every point on the system, and you can see a point on the system can be where a generator is connected to, or a large consumer, or a distribution company, or distribution substation that's near a residential area. These become pricing nodes. I just got done with Mexico discussing all this. In Mexico, they have 2,500 pricing nodes. Each 5 minutes, there is a separate price on each of the 2,500 nodes. There is a calculation of losses for each node. So start multiplying. Now there is a calculation for congestion for every node. We're talking about big data. Every 5 minutes being calculated on this market. If that wasn't enough, you have a market model and you have a load flow model that runs simultaneously to make sure that the trades can happen. We have even another time in this 5 minute period in which you run ancillary services without consumer input and then with consumer input. Massive amount of data. It's impressive. As a math major, I can appreciate the level of detail, how much information there is there. So for each node, we got three prices. We got the price for energy, we got the price for transmission losses, and we got the price for congestion. The problem is our dear friend Kirchhoff. We don't live in a perfect world, and it's a mesh system. A mesh system means it's not tangential. It means there's a mesh, Hashtag. Hashtag is probably the mesh. Power flows here. Just because you have congestion at one point doesn't mean that you're the only people on that side of the congestion that will be impacted by congestion pricing. Why? We'll go back to our loop flows. Remember our loop flows and so forth? You got to pay for somebody, whoever created the problem has to pay for it. And the nodal pricing system I cannot go into this, into the level of detail, but there's a general rules in Mexico. The market basis, it's 1,000 pages. They created the idea that if you did all the mathematics and just trust us, the software is going to work okay, that we can calculate what the problems are. Okay, what, let's say we do it here. We got prices all over Georgia, okay? Let's say we have prices all over Georgia. If you were on the wrong side, or the, let's say this is the wrong side, and this is the right side, you want to purchase energy. But on this side, the price should be your simple little curve, your first curve, and that's it. If you're over here, power's going to get redispatched because you can only send a limited amount across. So, and this power would have to be redispatched for you. On an economic, again, we're talking about an economic basis. These things would, because the day-ahead market is economic, the day-ahead market would say, okay, guys, you pick up, you shut down. Okay. So what does it do? Nodal pricing sends the signals every 5 minutes to consumers and to generators where there's a problem. Do they build transmission? Where does that money, by the way, where does that money go? Well, if you're on this side, the money, if they got redispatched, the congestion price is paid for the people here, but the money goes to the generator. What about the TSO? What does he think about this? I don't care. I don't care. I run a transmission network. It runs reliably. I don't really care. He's fine with that. But we, under nodal pricing, you are supposed to get the right, you know, Hogan said, you will get the right price. I've got every node on this system. I know what it costs to send power to my billing point, my pricing node.
So why does the TSO care? I mean, his lines are congested.
His lines aren't congested. It's an economic congestion.
Yeah, you're right.
It's an economic congestion.
As long as
if somebody says, I want to take power from here to here, he says, okay, then you generate over here. He just says, he doesn't care, okay? I've used up all, I've got, this is 1,000 megawatts. Somebody says, okay, I want, you know, all the power I can get, 900 megawatts, because you got to leave reserve. And he says, okay, there's a contract that I need to get more power. Okay, then this power plant will run over here. That's it. It's as simple as that. TSO doesn't care about economics. Do you care about economics? And do you care enough to invest money on transmission systems? It's a lot of money. I mean, it could be $500,000. If you spend $500,000, on that, will you ever get your money back? Will you ever? Maybe if somebody, by the way, builds a big power plant here. What happened? If you invested that money because you wanted to save money by bringing, and all of a sudden, build the power plant here, or, and I'll say in equivalent, whatever equivalent megawatts, let's say it's 1,000 megawatts, and it could be a solar power plant. Could be a wind, could be on this side. What happened to this investment that was made by the TSO? You can imagine what, you know, this customer is going to pay for something he's not using? Wow. This sounds familiar, doesn't it? Guys, this is real, and this is really what's happening right now in the system. But the nodal price is supposed to tell you, all right. What happened to me? Mm-hmm. I never got through this, did I? No. Yeah. What is the perspective? I think you've heard enough from me already. Yeah. Reliability is the only thing that matters to the TSO. They don't care about economic congestion. Engineering congestion must always be eliminated. That's their job. If you look at their license says their reliability must be blah, 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 and the generic will track their license for reliability. Generic does not track their for economic impact on the system. That's not their job. And economic congestion is not relevant to system operations, only to market operations. So at the difference between the two different approaches. Modal pricing based approach. They use all these pricing nodes all over. Use a huge program. You develop three prices for every, whatever, say, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, for generation costs, transmission losses, and congestion prices. You can buy financial transmission rights. And what well that means is that, let's say, remember this 900 megawatts I wrote here is the maximum? If you're on this side, you're going to say, huh, I want to make sure that I'm one of those who can use that line. So you buy financial transmission rights, FTRs, and you guarantee that you will have capacity on that interface. Others will not. So how do you do that? You do an auction. Highest price wins. So you have, if you have the greatest value from having that, you'll pay the most of the money. It's very pretty though. And then the revenues from the FDRs are to pay for new construction. Right? So that's the idea. You have financial transmission rights. You'll guarantee that you'll have space on that line. And these extra revenues, because there's nothing here. You're already paying for transmission service. This is extra money given to the TSO. They just put it in their pocket. Are there any requirements for the TSO to build this line? No. What is this? Has everybody seen this book? The 10-year network development plan? I mean, it's a book. It's a wonderful story. I ask you to look through this, skim through that, the GSC book. Try to find somewhere in that where it says, yeah, we're going to prioritize economic congestion. Find that. It's nowhere, guys. They're looking at this line. They're looking the line down to Armenia, the back-to-back. They're looking at supporting here and so forth, building the 220 line down here from Ahotsuka down to
Batumi. They think a lot about Northwest as well. A lot of stuff there.
Yeah. Where's this issue? You're not going to find it. You're going to find it. It's not there. Let's go on to this side. Oh, this is us. I mean, this is the way we approach it in Europe. This is the better way, right? we look at long-term network development plans, that big, thick book. We don't have this silly pricing going on here, collecting revenues or anything else. If we need to build transmission, we'll just increase the tariff. Gina's willing to do that, no problem, right? We'll just build transmission. But there, again, if you look at this, delivering generation, tying into international, and improving reliability. Those are their three criteria. So that big book is wonderful, but is not going to help markets. It does not help markets. We have a single market price. You notice that? There's only a single price. We don't have price here and price there. We just have price. Mm-hmm. There are some in Norway, in France, they have what we call counter trading, and it's sort of like congestion management, but it's only if congestion is identified in a particular pricing period. And if it is, then the TSO gets, hey, back down your machine, and hey, you pick up your machine, and hopefully the best. That's really what counter trading is about. That's as close as you're ever going to get to relieving market congestion in France and Norway. And we have this thing called transmission capacity, allocation, and congestion management. that also occurs, but right now we only have it at the borders. We do not have it internally. And I think it's because there's no recognition that there is congestion internally, even though if someone really took a look at it, they would find it. What is transmission capacity allocation? Anybody here ever done anything with transmission capacity allocation? No? It's at the border. It's on GSC site. They do, every day they run a program called GCAP, and they determine the amount of capacity that's available to be sold, and they put it up for auction. And sometimes the auction is for the next day, the next month, the next year. So they could do the same thing here. And this is what happens in Europe, across Europe. You, instead of just being at the point of interconnection with another country, Europe eventually is going to become one market. We think we're going to get there. We'll see. But here you could do it also as a particular interface. You could also do it there as well. So this one, massive mathematical program calculating everything to the nth degree. Here, I guess it's more like when I worked in the utility, we had the saying. We would measure it with a micrometer, mark it with a crayon, and cut it with a chainsaw. This is the way we approach it. Does anybody know what a chainsaw is? You know, you cut trees with chainsaws. So we try to go through this wonderful exercise of the network development plan being so precise. But in fact, in the end, it's still very crude. So the point being in all of this is, and I apologize for not getting all in the details of everything that's here, but you have a high level of analytical mathematics going on. This is a wonderful system. Then we have this system over here, which Europe uses and most of the rest of the world uses. In the end, the TSO doesn't care. And in fact, what has happened is it's not really, it's not resulted ever in the removal of economic congestion. And this is an issue that still needs to be resolved. And what I said is, before I asked you, should you or should you not build infrastructure? It's a hard question. It's a really tough question you have to ask yourself. Now, in Mexico, I would say they have allowed private investors, those who either are a generator or they are a trader or they are a major, say, factory. They are starting to allow them to build their own transmission or invest in their own. So if they identify that there is a problem at an interface, an investor can give money to CFE, the big transmission company. It's big. The peak load is 47 gigawatts, guys. Mexico is a gigantic market. You can give money to the transmission owner and sign an agreement, and they will build this line, and you will have first rights on that line. And if you don't use it, you can sell the rights to somebody else and recover your investment. It's a different twist. Does CFE need the line? No, they don't need the line. You're really building that line. This investor has got the right to do that. Now, the only reason I would build that line is if I had a long-term contract between here and here, say 30 years, and Europe doesn't allow long-term PPAs. You can only have 1 year. And there lies the crisis for Europe. Have we resolved this? Have we resolved the issue? No. Is it kind of an important issue? It's an extremely important issue. What is wrong? The markets are not efficient. We want the markets to be fully efficient. We have economic congestion. We don't have a solution yet. Should you build an enormous amount of transmission so anybody can buy from anybody else at any time? Europe is struggling with that issue now, right as we speak. Should you eliminate all potential economic congestion? And no, I mean, you're driving rates far beyond what consumers can afford. Infrastructure is too expensive. I've talked way too long.
So, two things. One, okay, this is, I agree that this is a very important problem, right, in general. But, so, the introduction of decentralized sources of generation, like all these renewables, right?
Yep.
So, they could provide some solution by exactly producing closer to the consumption, right? And that's...
Rooftop. Rooftop would be
exactly. So that would be the big size, but you could have a small size. Yes. Yeah. You just said rooftop, for example, or
yeah, it's coming. Rooftops are coming. That's what's coming. If I wouldn't call them the burbs, but if places where there are houses, and I think what did I say the IDPs? What a perfect look. What a perfect location for solar. It's out flat, hot, exposed to the sun, and every one of those rooftops could be rented or leased to an investor. And it just, you know, just put them on top. You don't have to buy the land. You just lease it for, they have very little money. I mean, if you give them something, they would be very happy. You could hire some to run this thing, to operate this thing. It would be great. What would that do? That's going to put... on this side, it's over here, right? Down in here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is the way that, and this is the way that a lot of the U.S. is going, Mexico is going under. You can see it's happening. That's the revolution that's happening, and a lot of this will go away. Will go away. And that's why I say it's very dangerous. It's very dangerous right now to build large transmission, because with the revolution of having customers involved in the markets, I mean, if they decide. We're going to be involved heavily around this area. That means a lot of this is just not needed anymore.
What do you think about the storage? I mean, storage is also developing a lot.
Incredible.
That will do the same.
Right? It will. I mean, I always use Tesla as the example. You know, I know we're going more into my favorite topic. Thank you for opening it up. One of the guys that used to work here on our project, Valery Vlachkov, he's from Bulgaria, and he was just telling us about, you know, this was, what, 5 years ago in Spain, where you have your house, and outside your house, you have a connection, electricity connection. You bring your car here. I don't know if anybody can see this. You bring your car here, your electric car, and you connect it. And it used to be battery packs, but you know in Tesla, it's like the fifth, there's a layer of battery that's on the bottom of the car. But let me use battery packs because it's more better illustrative, like that, okay? So you have a battery pack. You sign an agreement with the TSO, and the TSO has control of that point overnight. You can't leave. Once you plug it in, you have to walk away and you can't touch that car until the morning. Why? Because the TSO will charge it, discharge, charge it, and discharge. On average, on that system in Spain, this was 5 years ago, three times every night, cars are charged and discharged. Why? What does this do for you? Does so many things for you. Storage is, this is just one of the examples that's happening in the revolution. The more electric cars are, the more it's going to change. What happens to the spinning reserve? There it is. There's your spinning reserve, guys. And it's instantaneous. You don't have to worry about the exciter kicking in and the turbine turning and the inertia. This thing goes, you push and goes up. You push and goes down. It's instantaneous like that. I know that Solar City is building, and they just got done fabricating 1 megawatt battery, and those are for grid. Yeah, and I think they're going to go up to 10 megawatts. So you put these everywhere. You don't put them in one spot. You put these everywhere, and all of a sudden, your solar PV during the day is just chunking into there,
yeah.
And at nighttime, It's coming back. But you can do this during the night, too. You can pay it, you can recharge it, whatever it is. It's the perfect system. It's the perfect system. And if you have a windmill, oh, good Lord, here we go again. My awful drawings. Okay. By the way, they're up to... Yeah, they're up to, what, 80 meters now is the point. The normal point is 80 or meters or more now. This technology. I realized it finally that the higher you go up, the higher you wind. Mm-hmm. I was in Honduras and they had shut down half the plants. The wind was too high. It was really too hard. And you have days like that. But the wind is really good. But if you have that and it's filtered through a battery system, what do you get out to the end? Here, this is doing this, right? Wind, blah, blah. Here, yeah, like that. Those storage systems provide you exactly the type of generation you want. Or it can go up. I mean, it can go up, it can come down. As the system operator needs it. It's you know, is it coming? Yeah, I'd say 5 to 10 years, you're gonna have something that's cost effective.
Yeah, the price of per megawatt is going down in the batteries. So,
it is, so it is. Well, you know, when I started, oh my God, that was 40 some years ago. It was $12,000 a kilowatt.
Wow.
For solar PV. And now, as I was saying, I can go to Texas, and they've offered to deliver it to my home in Armenia at $1,000 a kilowatt. And this is a small system. That's not a big system, guys. This is a small system. So the bigger ones could even be cheaper. Solar City, which is, again, is Elon Musk's group, just signed a long-term agreement with Nevada Power for 20 years. I think it was 3.2, 3.5 cents a kilowatt hour. This is solar energy. Oh, this is incredible. It's incredible. The change is happening. It is happening. And you can put this, okay, solar's not going to be fantastic in Georgia, but it's still going to be okay. It's much
what's
better
the,
than Germany.
What's the life cycle of the solar panel?
25 years.
They guarantee.
Warranty. Warranty
is 25 years. Yeah. But it doesn't mean that after 25 years it's not
working. It's just an efficiency of 80% after 25 years.
Right.
It could work for 50 years.
There is so much knowledge about solar. Why don't we
just
put solar here?
Not pre-feasibility, but they're looking at it in Gorda Bunny. An American company that's looking at it in Gorda Bunny.
You said solar's price is 3.5 cents?
This is long-term power purchase agreement between Solar City, which is owned by Elon Musk, and Nevada Power.
So prices are going down
huge,
very fast.
Huge down.
So based on it, should we build big hydropower, start building now? It's going to take maybe 3, 4, 5 years.
There's a revolution going on, that's all I can say.
Question about that.
I believe they run a river. I don't believe in large dams. I do believe in run a river still.
Well, if you combine it also with that.
Yeah.
But following that question about the large dams, I mean, large dams are pretty much doing more or less the same thing as a battery.
Yep.
Right? But they are doing that.
They have some other things
and
that they provide.
And they're doing that
climate change and other things that you don't like.
Yeah.
Just about the cost of the dam, really.
It's, the uncertainty. I saw something from the World Bank. Whatever price was estimated, by the time it got done with a large dam project, large reservoir, on average, it's 95% more than what they estimated at the time of investment. It always doubles.
Not to mention that if you have a very large dam and it is located on the wrong side, it doesn't solve the congestion. But
it
the batteries you can move everywhere.
Oh,
the run river are probably more distributed than locations for big dams. So unless you have a location in a place that is really power hungry, which gives is a very good idea, but you see if it is very far, it might be costly.
One of the things, what was it, back in, Sophie will probably knows this, we looked at aluminum aluminum factory in Pote or something. One of our original thoughts was, okay, over here is where the power is. Let's put the, you know, and it needs a really strong connection between the energy sector and the economy, Ministry of Economy. And those two need to work hand in hand to be able to do that. That doesn't always happen. And, you know, you have to book concessions. Maybe it's the tax revenues. Maybe there's something else but that will help in that situation. But economic growth, the really good jobs, everything else. That aluminum factory was one. There was another one. Google was another one. Google, yeah. But the problem was frequency control. There's the problem. It's not regulated enough in Georgia yet. When Georgia joins the European network of transmission system operators, and it has to put in all the controls, then a company like Google can come in. You have to have, you know, the frequency controls on all those automated processes. The frequency controls how accurate you are, and the range and the frequency in this country is too high for be able to do that precision. So in the future, when the frequency is controlled in a much better way, and it will be, I guarantee you that, then companies like that can be put in, but hopefully in the West and not in the East. That would be good.
Did you say Google's new, so they have this map of like rooftop solars? So like they designed this map of every rooftop in the US, and so it like really assesses the potential of every rooftop?
That's neat. Yeah,
that's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what they're thinking. Everybody's thinking from the consumer side. That's the revolution that's happening. It's all driven by the consumer, the market, and no more about, you know, we were joking today about how we used to do demand. I was working in dispatch in 60 something. And they said, Jake, you're responsible for demand forecasting for the company. Oh, thank you. And so what did I do? I said, okay. This is the historical amounts, right? So how long did it take me to create the demand forecast for the next 20 years? Let's see. Done. Demand is done. We're all over. We can go home now. And I am not joking. I'm not joking. We added a little bit of capacity for reserves, right? For reliability. So you take your peak load, add some reserves. Therefore, that's the amount of capacity I need to go out and buy. And I would go out and I'd be looking for either construction or purchases on the market to make sure that we had enough capacity for the market. That was it. That was long-term planning. We got a little bit more sophisticated later and even now. But it's still internally sector focused. It needs to be more market focused. And I have promised Jeaner that I will come back, probably here, and with Rezo's permission, and we will talk in depth about where we should go with market-based or market-centered energy planning. And I'd rather have it though around, I'd rather this be a table. And we can all, you know, really argue about these things back and forth, because I would prefer that rather than this. But I think that would be very useful. And I'd like to hear what your thoughts are, not just hear me. I'd like to hear what your thoughts are about how we can go about doing market-centered energy planning. Or again, I'll call it customer choice, because customer options. The one thing I can do is I can show you examples from other countries and where the customer has now got options. And the options are growing every day. And then we can talk about how that can somehow blend back into energy planning for the ministries. That's why Opto is, I'm going to work with him on this, right? Yeah.
Because have you seen current plans of ministries? That's what they do.
Yeah, Aldo and I were the same. We were told it's going to be 5%, whether you like it or not. And I'll go back, duck curve. Look at the duck curve from California. Look at all the articles written and what disaster that's creating and why nobody has been able to respond to it. They're trying to respond to a market issue with an engineering solution. You can't do that. You have to resolve it with an economic issue. Look at and let the market dictate how to best serve it. It's crazy. It's really crazy what's going on. And the utilities are lagging. The traders are the ones pushing, and the traders are the ones who are really letting the customers change the way they're thinking. Yeah? I'm sorry I didn't get in. I probably, you're wondering, I thought I was going to talk really about nodal pricing and understand it. I would say that it is at least one course at a university, if not two courses, to fully understand nodal pricing. But the fact that there's a price at every point on the system every 5 minutes to send a signal to the traders that there's a problem, that's what I wanted you to hear. It's very sophisticated. It's completely different than what is done in Europe. And I don't think it helps at all. And that's why me and Mr. Hogan have a problem. It hasn't relieved any congestion at all. Because the congestion is economic, it's not technical or engineering. That's the problem. All right? How was that? Okay? Yeah. At least it's a start, you know? One of the guys that used to work here on our project, Valery Vlachkov, he's from Bulgaria, and he was just telling us about, you know, this was, what, 5 years ago in Spain, where you have your house, and outside your house, you have a connection, electricity connection. You bring your car here. I don't know if anybody can see this. You bring your car here, your electric car, and you connect it. And in, well, it used to be battery packs, but you know in Tesla, it's like the there's a layer of battery that's on the bottom of the car. But let me use battery packs because it's more better illustrative, like that, okay? So you have a battery pack. You signed an agreement with the TSO. And the TSO has control of that point overnight. You can't leave. Once you plug it in, you have to walk away, and you can't touch that car until the morning. Why? Because the TSO will charge it, discharge it, and discharge. On average, on that system in Spain, this was 5 years ago, three times every night, cars are charged and discharged. Why? What does this do for you? There's so many things for you. Storage is, this is just one of the examples that's happening in the revolution. The more electric cars are, the more it's going to change. What happens to the spinning reserve? There it is. There's your spinning reserve, guys. And it's instantaneous. You don't have to worry about the exciter kicking in and the turbine turning and the inertia. This thing goes, you push, it goes up. You push, it goes down. It's instantaneous like that. I know that Solar City is building, and they just got done fabricating 1 megawatt battery. And those are for grid. Yeah? And I think they're going to go up to 10 megawatts. So you put these everywhere. You don't put them in one spot. You put these everywhere. And all of a sudden, your solar PV during the day is just chunking into there.
Yeah.
And at nighttime, it's coming back. But you can do this during the night, too. You can hold it, you can recharge it, whatever it is. It's the perfect system. It's a perfect system. And if you have a windmill, oh, good Lord, here we go again. My awful drawings. Okay. By the way, they're up to...
It's good.
Yeah, they're up to, what, 80 meters now is the point. The normal point is 80 or meters or more now. This technology. I realized that finally that the higher you go up, the higher you wind.
Mm-hmm.
I was in Honduras, and they had shut down half the plants. The wind was too high. I mean, it was really too hard. And you have days like that. But the wind is really good. But if you have that, and it's filtered through a battery system, what do you get out to the end? Here, this is doing this, right? Wind, blah, blah. Here, like that. Those storage systems provide you exactly the type of generation you want. Or it can go up. I mean, it can go up, it can come down. As the system operator needs it. It's you know, is it coming? Yeah, I'd say 5 to 10 years, you're going to have something that's cost effective.
Yeah, the price of per megawatt is going down in the batteries. So
it is. It is. Well, you know, when I started, oh my God, that was 47 years ago. It was $12,000 a kilowatt.
Wow.
For solar PV. And now, as I was saying, I can go to Texas, and they've offered to deliver it to my home in Armenia at $1,000 a kilowatt. And this is a small system. That's not a big system, guys. It's a small system. So the bigger ones could even be cheaper. Solar City, which is, again, is Elon Musk's group, just signed a long-term agreement with Nevada Power for 20 years. I think it was 3.2, 3.5 cents a kilowatt hour. This is solar energy. Oh, this is incredible. It's incredible. The change is happening. It is happening. And you can put this, okay, solar's not going to be fantastic in Georgia, but it's still going to be okay. It's much
what's
better
the,
than Germany.
What's the life cycle of the solar panel?
25 years.
They guarantee.
Warranty.
The warranty is 25 years. Yeah.
But it doesn't mean that after 25 years it's not working. It's just an efficiency of 80% after 25 years.
Right.
It could work for 50 years.
There is so much knowledge about solar. Why don't we
just
put
have
solar here?
Not pre-feasibility, but they're looking at it in Gordon Bunny. It's an American company that's looking at it in Gordon Bunny.
Jake, you said solar's price is 3.5 cents.
This is long-term power purchase agreement between Solar City, which is owned by Elon Musk, and Nevada Power.
So prices are going down
really
fast.
Huge down.
So based on it, should we build big hydropower, start building now? It's going to take maybe 3, 4, 5 years.
There's a revolution going on, that's all I can say.
Question about that.
I believe they run a river. I don't believe in large dams. I do believe in running a river still.
Well, if you combine it also in that way.
Yeah.
But following that question about the large dams, I mean, large dams are pretty much doing more or less the same thing as a battery.
Yep.
Right?
But
they are doing that.
They have some other things
and
that they provide.
And they're doing that
climate change and other things that you don't like.
Just about the cost of the dam, really.
So we should have a discussion.
It's, the uncertainty. I saw something from the World Bank. Whatever price was estimated, by the time it got done with a large dam project, large reservoir, on average, it's 95% more than what they estimated at the time of investment. It always doubles.
Not to mention that if you have very large diamond, it is located on the wrong side. It doesn't solve the congestion.
It does
the batteries you can move everywhere.
Oh,
there are no rivers, are probably more distributed than locations for big diamonds. So unless you have a location in a place that is really power hungry, which is a very good idea, but it's, if it is very far, it might be costly.
One of the things, what was it, back in, Sophie will probably knows this, we looked at aluminum factory in Poti or something. One of our original thoughts was, okay, over here is where the power is. Let's put the, and it needs a really strong connection between the energy sector and the economy, Ministry of Economy. And those two need to work hand in hand to be able to do that. That doesn't always happen. And you have to book concessions. Maybe it's the tax revenues. Maybe there's something else, but that will help in that situation. But economic growth, the really good jobs, everything else. That Lumen factory was one. There was another one. Google was another one. Google. Yeah, but the problem was frequency control. There's the problem. It's not regulated enough in Georgia yet. When Georgia joins the European network of transmission system operators, and it has to put in all the controls, then a company like Google can come in. You have to have, the frequency controls on all those automated processes, the frequency controls how accurate you are. And the range and the frequency in this country is too high for be able to do that precision. So in the future, when the frequency is controlled in a much better way, and it will be, I guarantee you that, then companies like that can be put in, but hopefully in the West and not in the East. That would be good.
Did you see Google's new, so they have this map of like rooftop solars? So like they designed this map of every rooftop in the US, and so it like really assesses the potential of every rooftop in
the States. That's neat. Yeah.
That's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what they're thinking. Everybody's thinking from the consumer side. That's the revolution that's happening. It's all driven by the consumer, the market, and no more about, we were joking today about how we used to do demand. I was working in dispatch in 60 something. And they said, Jake, you're responsible for demand forecasting for the company. Oh, thank you. And so what did I do? I said, okay, this is the historical amounts, right? So how long did it take me to create the demand forecast for the next 20 years? Let's see. Done. Demand is done, we're all over. We can go home now. And I am not joking. Of course, we added a little bit of capacity for reserves, right? For reliability. So you take your peak load, add some reserves. Therefore, that's the amount of capacity I need to go out and buy. And I would go out and I'd be looking for either construction or purchases on the market to make sure that we had enough capacity for the market. That was it. That was long-term planning. We got a little bit more sophisticated later and even now. But it's still internally sector focused. It needs to be more market focused. And I have promised Jeaner that I will come back, probably here, and with Rezo's permission, and we will talk in depth about where we should go with market-based or market-centered energy planning. And I'd rather have it though around, I'd rather this be a table. And we can all, really argue about these things back and forth, because I would prefer that rather than this. But I think that would be very useful. And I'd like to hear what your thoughts are, not just hear me. I'd like to hear what your thoughts are about how we can go about doing market-centered energy planning. Or again, I'll call it customer choice, because customer options. The one thing I can do is I can show you examples from other countries and where the customer has now got options. And the options are growing every day. And then we can talk about how that can somehow blend back into energy planning for the ministries. That's why Opto is, I'm going to work with him on this, right? Yeah.
Because have you seen current plans of ministries? Just that's what they do.
Yeah.
It's truly like,
Aldo and I were the same. We were told it's going to be 5%, whether you like it or not. And the, I'll go back, duck curve. Look at the duck curve from California. Look at all the articles written and what disaster that's creating and why nobody has been able to respond to it. They're trying to respond to a market issue with a engineering solution. You can't do that. You have to resolve it with an economic issue. Look at and let the market dictate how to best serve it. It's crazy. It's really crazy what's going on. And the utilities are lagging. The traders are the ones pushing, and the traders are the ones who are really letting the customers change the way they're thinking. Yeah. I'm sorry I didn't get in. I probably you're wondering. I thought I was going to talk really about nodal pricing and understand it. I would say that it is at least one course at a university, if not two courses, to fully understand nodal pricing. But the fact that there's a price at every point on the system every 5 minutes to send a signal to the traders that there's a problem, that's what I wanted you to hear. It's very sophisticated. It's completely different than what is done in Europe. And I don't think it helps at all. And that's why me and Mr. Hogan have a problem. You know, it hasn't relieved any congestion at all. Because the congestion is economic, it's not technical or engineering. That's the problem. All right? How was that? Okay? At least it's a start, you know?